Hi everyone, thank you so much for joining this Power Hour workshop. My name's Adrienne Herbert, I am a wellness coach, I'm the author of Power Hour, and I'm the host of the Power Hour podcast. So like many of you, I'm sure, I am a multifaceted woman. I like to do lots and lots of different things. I often wear lots of different hats. Sometimes I am training for an endurance event, like a marathon. I have a 10-year-old son, so sometimes I am in my mum mode. Other times I might be interviewing an athlete or a business CEO for the podcast. So like many of you, I am ambitious, I have lots of goals. And so in this session, I really wanted to talk about the concept of the Power Hour, but also about how to choose, how to decide, okay, what are the goals that you want to achieve and how to really focus on them and then make them happen. So, you know, of course, I want you to hopefully feel motivated, to feel inspired, but motivation alone is not going to be enough. I want you hopefully after this workshop to take action and have goals that you can go after and have a plan to actually make them happen. So that said, if you have some paper, if you have a journal, if you have some plain paper, that'd be great if you could grab that and some pens as well. If not, you can maybe make a note on your phone. And at the end, I'm going to be answering questions. So if you think of any questions throughout the workshop, then please just drop them in the chat box and I'll try and answer as many of the questions as I can at the end. So kicking off with a bit of an introduction, as I said, who I am, what I do, and why I'm so passionate about the Power Hour. So as I mentioned, on the Power Hour podcast, I'm incredibly lucky. I get to sit down and have conversations with so many amazing, high-performing people, from Olympic athletes to best-selling authors, nutritionists, psychologists. And I try to really find out what motivates people to get up out of bed every morning. Why do they do what they do? What's the journey that they've been on to success and to failure? How have they navigated the different challenges in their careers? How do they approach risk and failure? And I really want to, yeah, understand the essence of what motivates them, but also how they actually got to do what they do. And so I explored that more in the book as well. And one of the things when it comes to, as I mentioned before, like setting goals, is that for many busy people, they don't have enough time. We're time poor people. And so that's really where the concept of Power Hour began for me, because the 5-6 years ago, when I didn't have a Power Hour, I didn't have a morning routine, but I definitely felt like I was taking on more things. I was starting to feel this busyness that we all can probably relate to. But I felt like I needed to refocus, and I'd had a really difficult year, to be honest, and I felt like I just wanted a fresh start. I wanted to just focus my energy and to start something new. So at the time I was like, okay, my son was young, I was managing, like I said, lots of things, and I thought, okay, the best way for me to, I guess, claim back some time and carve out some more space to achieve all these things that I wanna do is to get up a little bit earlier, 1 hour earlier actually, and to take some time back for myself. So that's where it kind of started, and it wasn't like, you know, this overnight transformation and suddenly everything in my life was different, but it really was the first domino to fall. It was that first thing that made me go, wow, okay, this is really empowering actually, to say, I'm gonna start every day with 1 hour for myself. And that's when the Power Hour was born. And I basically decided that I signed up for my first ever marathon. And for people that know me now, they'll know I love to run. I've done loads and loads of races. But back then, I had never run more than, I'd never run more than 10K. So the thought of doing a marathon was a huge, huge challenge. So I was running a lot in the morning. So I'd start that hour, I'd get up, I'd go out, and it was heading into winter, so it was starting to get dark, kind of like it is now in the mornings. And I'd listen to a podcast or I'd listen to a book, and I'd just spend that first hour doing whatever I wanted to do. If I wasn't running that day, I might do some stretches, I might write in my journal. But I think the real key about it wasn't what I was doing in the time, but it was the mindset shift. As I say, deciding that the first hour, I am important and I'm gonna choose something that I wanna do. Now, often when I first share this concept with people, I say, okay, the Power Hour, first hour of your day, reclaim that time. And I use the word reclaim very intentionally, because reclaim literally means to take back something that was previously yours, that was lost or stolen. And for many people, when they open their eyes in the morning, from the first minute they wake up till they go to bed at night, they are doing. They are giving to others. They are doing, whether it's work, whether it's WhatsApps, emails, kids, all these different things and they don't have any time. That's what people tell me. They say, Adrienne, this sounds great, but I'm time poor. You know, I have a job, I have kids, I have all these things. So that was the first thing, was saying, okay, what you do with that hour is completely up to you. But taking that hour is the first mindset shift to say, it is not selfish, it is not self-indulgent, it is necessary and it is important and you deserve it. It is what you deserve. So deciding to take that first hour is the first thing. And then figuring out, okay, what do I want to do? If I'm going to get up an hour earlier, it's certainly not about productivity or just getting up earlier just to do more. It's actually essentially the opposite of that. It's saying, carve out, reclaim, take that hour back. And all those things that you often say, oh, I'd love to do that, but I don't have enough time. You know, I'd love to read more, but I don't have time. Or I'd love to, all of those things that I often hear, that's when I want you to think about the power hour and say, okay, could you start, maybe it's not every day, maybe you start 1 or 2 days a week and say, could you wind your alarm clock back 1 hour, and then in the morning, before the rest of the world needs your time, your energy, your attention, your focus, can you give that hour to yourself? So that's where it started for me. And then when I started the Power Hour podcast, as I said, I started to ask other people, okay, what do they do in their first hour? Why do they do it? Are there any things that these high performing, you know, highly successful people, is there anything that they eliminate in the mornings and why? So some common themes that came up were people talking about movement and exercise. And obviously being in the fitness and wellness industry myself for the last 10 years, I could really understand and relate to that having a routine that involves movement in the morning. But it doesn't have to be just one kind of movement or exercise. And I even use the word movement intentionally instead of exercise because, you know, often people hear the word exercise and they'll say they have a love-hate relationship. They either love it and they're really, really into fitness, or they're like, oh, I don't want to hear that. So when I say movement, it's because it can literally be anything that you enjoy that gets your body moving first thing in the morning. Now, I'm certainly not going to, as I said, I've worked in the fitness and health industry for 10 years. I'm certainly not going to waste any of the time in this workshop telling you that exercise is good for you, and we're going to feel endorphins, and we're going to burn calories. We all know that. I think we can just Google like all the reasons exercise is good for you. If we just needed to know it, then we'd all be super healthy, super fit, and super active. But just knowing it isn't enough. So I think really it's about finding out, okay, is it important to you? How do you want to feel during the day? For example, we think about, I'm someone who likes to run, still love to run. And for me, it's because I have a lot of energy and I like to start the day with forward motion. So if I head out for a run and I know, okay, I'm going from here to here, I'm going from something away from something and towards something else. So for me, that's just a feeling of forward motion and progress, and progression is something that makes me feel like, you know what, that's a good start to my day. It gives me more energy than it takes. Whereas if I know people that say they like to start their day with, when it comes to movement anyway, strength training or HIIT training or boxing, because they want to break a sweat and they want to feel that kind of, that wakes them up in the morning. For others, it's more of a movement that is going to be calming and that is going to evoke a feeling of control and stillness, and kind of in a world that's busy and chaotic, sometimes actually starting your day with a yoga practice or Pilates or something that just encourages you to be calm and still and to say, you know what, I can remain in this difficult position or this difficult posture and I can breathe through it. I'm not going to panic. I don't need to freak out. I can stay here. I can endure. And just that to yourself before you even start your day. It's like, if I can do that, what else? You know, and I say that again with the running. It's like, if I can do that before I've even had a shower, before I've taken my son to school, before I've started looking at emails, then what else can you do? So you start to build this confidence over time through repetition. And that certainly happened for me. The confidence of doing. People often ask about confidence, like, how can you improve confidence? It is not something you're simply born with or without. It comes through repetition. So the more times you do something, you go, okay, if I can do that, maybe I can do 5 miles. If I can do 5 miles, maybe I can do 6. And before you know it, you're like, I can literally do it all. I can do it all. So pick a kind of movement. If you're thinking, okay, power hour sounds good, maybe I haven't been moving as much as I want to. We have very sedentary lives now, whether that's because of, you know, pre-pandemic, during the pandemic, hybrid working, working from home, a lot of us can just open our eyes and go straight to a laptop, open it, and we don't move. So if you can, incorporate some movement into your power hour, whether that's a cycle around the block, a run, some yoga, something. If it is, you know, doing something hard, break a sweat before you have a shower, then start to prioritize that time for yourself and make movement a part of your morning. For other people, it's like, okay, no, that's not it. It's actually focus. And I am someone who is very easily distracted. If I'm in a room full of people, I am a social person. I want to talk, I want to chat. I just don't focus on my work, and then I have to go and do it later at home. So that's me in an office environment. So the work from home situation is quite good for me. But if there's something that you know requires focus, then of course, there are a lot of distractions throughout the day. And actually creating time for solitude first thing in the morning, it's so much easier to have that solitude and to have that time without distraction. So when I get up, which is typically between 5:30 and 5:45 every day, I know not always what you wanna hear, but that is my power hour, then there's no one sending me emails. There's no one sending me WhatsApps. My son is still asleep. So the idea that I can really focus, to be honest, I wouldn't have been able to write the book if I hadn't have had a power hour, because that is when I can do my most focused work, free from distraction. And also again, feeling like I can just choose myself in that hour because no one else is expecting anything from me. There's no obligation to be anywhere or do anything for anyone else. So if it's not a movement thing, you don't want to go out for a run, but you have lots of things that you'd love to do if you had more time, then what's to say that actually starting your day with that thing, that project, whether it's a book you want to read, something, ideas you want to write down, just maybe you want to grab your coffee and just sit and think about it, but do it first thing. Do it in the morning when you, if you imagine your list of priorities in a day, your to-do list, put yourself at the top. Often people wait till the bottom, the end of the day. Once I've done this and all my work and I've done the kids and I've done the thing, if there's any energy left, then right at the end of the day, I'll do the thing that I wanted to do. So bring yourself right up to the top of your to-do list. That's the first thing. And then use that time of solitude and no distractions to really focus and take that time for yourself. And then last thing I want to say around the kind of concept of this, you know, first hour of the day, I'm sure it's not the first time that you've, you know, thought about having a morning routine or read a book about morning routine, but this idea of, as I say, prioritization and choosing to put yourself at the top of your to-do list. I'd also like to challenge you to say, okay, what are all the things on your list? Because I know someone like me, I love to write to-do lists. And so many times people will say, oh, I'm busy, I don't have time for this, I don't have time for that. But they kind of think they're gonna have more time in the future. You know, we're all guilty of doing that. So it's like, Adrienne, this is great, but when this happens, then I'm gonna do it, okay? So when my kids are older, or when I've got more money, or when I've lost weight, or next year, and it's always when. So if you know, we're all guilty of doing that, I'm sure, but to be honest with you, the kind of the urgency that I live with and the reason that I do this every day is because too often tomorrow stays tomorrow for so many of us and for so many things. So it's not just a cliche motivational thing to say, you know what, live now. But in reality, the last 2 years has taught us that we never know what is going to happen and what to expect. So I really think if there's something where you're like tomorrow, 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 please don't let it stay tomorrow. Live with urgency, choose yourself and think, okay, when we got onto the goal setting part, what's it really gonna take for me to achieve that? What's it gonna take in 12 months, in 6 months, in 1 month, in 1 week, tomorrow? What could you do tomorrow in your power hour, in the first hour of the day, to start to create that life that you love, to do that thing, to choose yourself? So I really want you to hear that. Prioritize and choose yourself. All right, so this is where you're gonna need your paper and pen. So if you've got a paper, pens, journal, whatever, grab that now. And I wanna talk about goals and goal setting, because often people talk about goals and it's great if you're someone, as I said, who's ambitious, you're high achieving, you're smart, you want to train for a marathon, you want to get a promotion at work, you want to read more books, spend more time with your kids. Lots of high performing people want to do it all. And I think that when it comes to goals and setting goals, I would never say to anyone, oh, be more realistic or, you know, limit your ambition. Never. Trust me, the things that I've done in my life, I think that, you know, we can really do anything we want to do, but we cannot do all those things at the same time. So when it comes to setting goals, that's where I think often people get overwhelmed. They say everything's going to change. So it's like, okay, great. I'm going to work out more. I'm going to read more books. I'm going to eat better. I'm going to go to sleep more. It's more, 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 more. We layer these things on top. And then we wonder why, A, we're feeling overwhelmed. And B, we're just like, as soon as it, you know, a couple of days time, we're all or nothing. We give it up and we're like, oh, I'm rubbish and I can't do any of those things. I listen to that talk and forget it. But actually it's because we're just trying to do everything at the same time. So I mentioned that, you know, working in the fitness and health industry, and I do endurance events myself. I'm an endurance runner. So if you think about a season or in a year for an athlete, there's seasons. So there's time for training, there's time for competition, there's time for recovery. They don't do them all at the same time. So I like to think of my own year like that. I like to think of the seasons and think, okay, what is this season right now? So if you've got your pen and paper, then basically all you need to do is do a big circle in the middle of the page. So first things first, big circle in the middle, and then you write your goal in the center of that paper. So obviously it's not the word goal, you write your goal in the center. So that could be a professional goal, it could be a personal goal, and maybe you want to do two. Maybe you do one personal on one page, one professional on the other. But you have the goal in the center, and it's one. Okay, so we're not having a long list. Then you can see it, you've committed to it, you can see really clearly in black and white, okay, this is what the goal is. So it's good to have, you know, a visual reminder. But the next thing you need to do is you need to get specific. It can't be vague, okay? So you've got to make this goal specific. You need to, for example, like if you write, if you put some little, you know, sticks going off like this, like that, so you've got sticks sticking off, and then you want to put information. The more detail you can give me, the better, or yourself. If I was working with you one-to-one, I'd be like, I want all the detail. I don't just want this vague goal that's like, okay, Adrienne, I want to earn more money. So, okay, that is not a good goal. Is it you want to earn 10% more money, or you want to double your income, or you want to, what is the goal? You know, I want to get fit. What does that mean? Does that mean you want to get stronger and you're going to do strength training? You want to lift heavy? Does that mean you want to run a half marathon and you need to increase your stamina and endurance? What does the goal mean? Specific. So make it specific. And then, as I said, populate as much information on this paper as you can, because that is going to help you when, you know, all the questions I always often get asked around, you know, motivation and consistency. If you have this paper, essentially, if you have all the information on there already, so, okay, this is what the goal is. Again, I'll give you a really, really detailed example so we can kind of break it down. I do a lot of public speaking. I've delivered a TEDx talk, and often people will say to me, I want to do a TED talk. That's a goal. So they're like, right, their goal is they want to do a TED talk. But then that's it. So they might have a vision board. They might have something where they've written it down, a journal, but there's no detail. So I want to know, next thing I want to know is, okay, which one? Because there's loads of TEDx's all over the world. So is it London? Is it Bristol? Is it Berlin? Is it, where is this? Where is this talk happening? Then you can find out when. When do they book the speakers? Is it September? Okay, well, if the event's in September, maybe they book them 3 months before. Who books them? Can you go on Twitter? Can you find them? Can you find their email address? Okay, cool, you found the email. And you know they book the speakers in June. Now we're getting somewhere. Now we have a plan. We've got, you know, specifics. So that is how granular I want this plan to be. The more information you can put down, the better, because then you can make that actionable, that goal a reality. So as I mentioned before, think of the year as a season. So if you've got 12 months and that's the goal, then okay, what would it take, firstly, what would it take really to achieve that goal in 12 months? No excuses, no barriers, no blockers, what would it take? Then what would it take to do it in 6 months? What would it take to do it in 3 months? 1 month, 1 week, or at least where would you need to be on your timeline and what could you do tomorrow? Because ultimately, again, when I talk about, you know, living your life with this purpose and energy and urgency to do the things you want to do, what is our whole life made up of? It's years, it's months, it's weeks, it's days, it's now. So that's what I challenge myself to do with every single goal. What would it take? And then I mentioned excuses, blockers, barriers, whatever you want to call them. Sometimes people don't like the word excuses, but I like to hold myself to account with that. So we all have them. We all have barriers and blockers and things that come up in life. We all have, you know, curveballs, but the difference is if you're not expecting them, then they will just hit you in the face and you're just like, oh, I can't do it now. And you can have like, almost like something lets you off the hook, you know, because, oh, that happened, so it's not my fault, I couldn't do it. But actually, if you expect them and you write them down, okay, these are the things that could prevent me from achieving this goal, you've written them down. So you're ready when they come, you know? And like I said, going back to this idea of athletes and training in a season, injury, it happens. I don't know, weather conditions, they might change on race day. They know what those potential blockers and barriers could be, and they prepare for them so that they can still perform at their best, they can still deliver, they can still compete, they can still do what they need to do to achieve the goal, regardless of what is gonna come, because that is life. I'm certainly never gonna say, you know, avoid stress, avoid, you know, anything that, it's not realistic. There will be stressful moments, there will be things that challenge us, and that's why I say, you can do anything, but not everything at the same time. So which season are you in right now? Is it the personal goal season and you're working hard towards that? Is it the professional goal season? And actually right now, it's all about that goal. And if some other things kind of are, imagine like you've got something that's colored in and like one thing is highlighted and the others are kind of grayed out. And then it switches to the other side and the focus changes throughout the year. Instead of just trying to have everything lit up all the time, family, friends, health, fitness, career, money, like all of these goals, which one are you pouring into now? And then maybe as a result, maybe it's a little bit less, you know, holiday time, free time. But then when you're pouring into that, really pour into that. You know, if you're doing things, whether it's, you know, like I said, a holiday or children with your kids, really pour into that season and just be there and do that one. So try and break them down, do them one at a time. So as I mentioned at the start, if you have questions, please do drop them in because I'm going to get to that at the end. And I know that when I do goal setting things, there's often lots and lots of questions around, yeah, as I said, motivation, consistency, and kind of really what that looks like. So please do drop them in and hopefully we'll have loads of time to answer them. And then the last part on this is about, I guess, decision making and how you make those decisions. Because again, as I said at the start, if you're someone with a lot of ambition and you want to do lots of things and you can, then it becomes the issue sometimes of, well, how do you prioritize? How do you choose? Okay, which thing to pursue? Which thing to say no to? Say no, I am a recovering people pleaser. Say no is a really hard thing to do. So when you figure out, okay, I need a system. That's what I'm quite a systematic person. I was like, I need a system. So my system when it comes to this decision-making process, how am I gonna choose the goals that I want to work towards, is around five different things. And the first one is values, interests. Is this something that aligns with me and my values, what I'm all about? Is this something that is exciting to me, this project or this opportunity or this job or this interview? Does this align with my values? Or is it something where I'm gonna have to kind of, not wing it, but you know, it doesn't really feel like it's you. So that's the first one. And that should be like, for me anyway, that's the first one that I can kind of feel it, you know? It's like, does this align? Is this exciting to me? Does this align with my values? The second one is learning. So is this an opportunity to learn? So this decision you're trying to make, it could be about work, it could be around a health fitness goal. Is this an opportunity to learn, to upskill, and to do something? Because any skill that you learn, any knowledge that you have, it's never, ever, ever gonna be wasted. So even in the moment, you might not think, I don't know, working on this specific project at work, you will learn some skills that you'll be able to take to something else in your life. So if it's an opportunity to learn, that's one way to one of the kind of lists that I'm looking at when I'm making a decision. The third one is doing things in service of others. So is this going to literally help someone else? So whether that's mentoring, whether that's helping with, you know, volunteering to do something, is this in service of others? Because I think innately we all want to do things in service of others, but sometimes we just don't know what that opportunity is, or again, we're time poor, so we think, oh, I'll do it, you know, next time I'll volunteer. But actually, if you have that on your list, then you can start to kind of, gives you a bit of a reminder and a bit of a prompt sometimes to say, is this something I can do in service of others to help out, to give my skills? Next on from that is money. If it's a, you know, if it's a career goal, if it's a goal, something, if it's gonna cost you money, or is it something that you're gonna pay for a course, or actually is it an opportunity where you can earn more money? And again, I don't think we should be too binary about that. I think it's a personal thing, but I don't think we should think, it's not a bad thing to say, actually, when I'm making decisions, I'm gonna factor in the cost. And actually, sometimes I talk about the fact that cost doesn't just mean money. There is different kinds of currency in my world. There's the cost of time, there's the cost of energy. What is this project? What is saying yes to this? What is that going to cost me? And is it worth it? So make sure you have cost as, yeah, money, time, and energy. And then last but not least, the fifth thing on my decision-making process is what is the fifth thing? What did we go through? We went through learning, we went through values, we went through service of others, money, and then the last one is enjoyment. So again, ironically, that leave that to last, but it's enjoyment. It's like, am I going to enjoy this thing? And again, as adults, we have so many things that we take on. We never think, I'm just going to do this because it's fun. And that is the only reason. You know, we have our, if you have young children, you'll see they go to gymnastics, they might do Lego, they might do football, they might do swimming. It's not because they're training to be a pro or because they're going to compete, but it's just because it's fun. And then sadly, I think as we grow up and we become adults, we do less of the fun things. We deprioritize play because no one's got time. And it just becomes, yeah, everything becomes goal orientated. So even if you're doing a hobby, we set ourselves goals. You know, yeah, everything becomes like it has to have an outcome that we can see and measure. So I like to have this little section, which is just like, am I actually going to enjoy this? Doesn't have to have an outcome that I can measure. Maybe it's just for fun. And then last but not least, in addition to, so you've got your paper, you've got all your different ideas around goal, the goal, what it is, and then you've gone through this decision-making process and you've figured out, yes, this is what I want to do. Always leave a little bit of space, which I call white space. So this is in my book, The Power Hour, which came out at the start of the year. This was something that, you know, I wrote about it and I was something that I practiced myself, but I didn't expect so many other people to, I guess, pull that out as their kind of key takeaway from the book, especially as the book is about, you know, setting goals and going after what you want in your life. So I was very surprised when lots of people said, yeah, the white space thing, that was really impactful for me. That was the thing I took from the book. So essentially what that is, the white space, is about having space, white space, whatever you want to call it, in your diary, in your schedule, and really in your life. Because if we don't have any white space, if everything is structured from, okay, waking up, I'm doing this, this is work, this is kids, this is I'm training, and then I'm here, everything is like a Tetris. So many people, their schedule is like a Tetris board. There is no white space. So if there's no white space, there's no time or space for creativity, for spontaneity, to just impulsively say yes when you get invited to do something because you actually have time, instead of saying, I'll get back to you, and then they get back to you, and then you get back to them, and then after 6 months, you finally have time to meet for lunch. You know, so like having some white space is so, so important for us to have this freedom, but also to have, I think after the pandemic, where we've, again, if you've been working from home or hybrid working, I think there's been more of an expectation on people to be online and to be available. So if you don't have white space blocked out, then often your space and your time will be filled by others. It will be taken from you. There'll be a meeting, there'll be a phone call, there'll be a workout, there'll be something in that time. So I have white space, you can put it as a hold if your diary is digital, you could just leave it in your calendar, pick a day every month if you just start with that, and just white space. Whatever you feel like doing on that day, you can do it. Which again, don't try not to fill it then with like, okay, I can do some more admin, I can clean my house. Like just try to, I don't know, maybe go for a long walk, maybe read that book that you've just had sitting there for ages, but just having some white space, really, really important. And the more you have it, the more you realize how essential it is, you'll start to just find more places to add white space. I try and have 20 minutes all over the place in most days where there's nothing there at all. It's just blocked out white space. So then you'll actually have the time to pursue some of these goals. Okay, I'm gonna pause for breath. Hopefully you can have a look at what you've written down. And then I'm gonna talk about the next thing I wanna talk to you about, which is a mindful exercise that you can do first thing in the morning. Okay, so we've decided we're gonna do a power hour. Gonna get up in the morning. Sounds great, Adrienne. But what are you gonna do in that time? So again, not about just doing more and more and more. So an exercise that I share in the book is called 6 questions to answer before 6. Now, if you are not an early bird and you're never gonna get up at 6, if you're like, that's never gonna happen, then I'll allow you to change the title to 6 questions to answer before 7. But after that, that's it, that's the 1 hour window. So basically the reason I have these questions is because, again, a lot of the guests that have come onto the podcast over the last almost 3 years have talked about journaling in the morning. So they'll say, okay, it's a really great mindful thing to do before they pick up the phone, before they start emails, before they leave the house. It's like, okay, I write in a journal. And it's like, okay, well, even that sometimes can be overwhelming. It's like, where do I start? I don't know what to write. I just woke up. Like, I don't even know where to start. So, and I'm also someone who, I don't want to say I was skeptical of like mindfulness, but I think working in the health and fitness industry, the way mindfulness was like kind of presented to me a few years ago was just close your eyes, take a deep breath, everything's calm. And that is not my vibe. That is not my energy. I'm someone who thrives in doing and in motion and in energy. So I didn't like, I just felt a bit repelled by this idea that I had to like take my precious time and just be, you know, Yoda-like, which of course is not what mindfulness is. But that is why I started this exercise, because I was like, okay, if all of these wonderful people, smart people, doctors, psychologists, if they're coming onto the podcast and I'm sitting there for an hour listening to the benefits of mindfulness, then I need to take it on board. I need to at least give it a try and be open-minded to change and to try these things out for myself. So the mindfulness exercise, I was like, okay, let me give it a go. And I wrote down 6 questions, and you can tailor these, you can change them, you can make them your own. But my 6 questions, the first one was, what am I most looking forward to today? So also to note, I did this every single day for 3 months and I didn't miss a day. Monday to Sunday, every day I did this first thing in the morning. So first one was, what am I most looking forward to today? And it can be something really small, something really simple, like having, you know, a nice hot coffee after my run, or it could be watching my son at his swimming lesson. But basically, just by writing it down, I was like, okay, that's what I'm looking forward to the most. And it made me, just brought awareness to, you know, the things that I have in my life that I enjoy. And then if there was a day when you really struggled to think of something, then you're like, okay, right, I need to make a change because my day must just be full of things that I don't want to do. So having something in there every day and going, okay, that's what I'm looking forward to. And then when you get to, when you do this practice all the time, when you get to that thing in the day, whatever it is that you wrote down, you really, really notice it because you're like, ah, okay, this was the thing. So I wrote down this morning, the thing I was looking forward to the most was X, and now I'm doing it. So you really kind of, yeah, you have this like awareness where you're like, right, I'm really going to enjoy this. I'm not going to do it whilst I'm looking at my phone or whilst I'm trying to send an email, or not going to multitask, I'm just going to do this thing. So that was the first one. The second one is, who can I learn from today? Now, again, I'm someone who is an advocate of lifelong learning, and I think there's so many ways you can take learning. Doesn't have to just be, you know, what is presented to us at school. It can be podcasts, it can be from friends. So who can I learn from today is a really good one to ask yourself, because A, it challenges you to keep learning, but B, it doesn't have to be, you know, it can literally just be watching a TED talk or watching a YouTube video or asking someone in your team for something that you're like, you know what, I don't really know much about that, I'm going to find out. So who can you learn from today? Challenge yourself. After a while, that was a tricky one to answer. The first week or two, I was like, great. And then I really had to, you know, work hard to find an answer for that one. And the next one is, who can I help today? In that kind of flipping that question around of who can learn from you. So is there someone in your team? Is there someone in your life? Is there someone who you could help? It doesn't have to, again, it doesn't have to be a huge thing going out of your way. Like, it could be sending an email of an introduction to say, oh, you should know this person. She's great. He's great. You two should know each other. Simple. But is there someone you can help, someone who can learn from you? Who is that person? Write down their name in your journal in the morning and then make it a priority to send them a WhatsApp or an email or whatever. The next one, so we've got the who can you learn from, what you're most looking forward to, and who can learn from you. So the next one that I like to write down in my journal when I do this exercise is about gratitude. So again, we hear it a lot in the mindful space. You know, what are you grateful for? But again, writing it down first thing in the morning, not at the end of the day looking back. If you write it down first thing, you can look for that answer throughout the day. So what is the thing that you're grateful for that you have? Again, it could be big, could be small, but going throughout your day looking for that answer is just, it's quite, when you make it a habit and you do it every day, it really starts to be impactful over time and you realize, wow, especially if you look back for like 4 weeks and you found something every single day to write down to be grateful for, it really is a huge game changer when it comes to your mindset, your mood, and just how you approach the rest of your day. So another one you could put on there, which I really like, is who would love to hear from me today? Now that question, and again, when I've shared this with people, they're like, that's the one that I sometimes, you know, forget, but who would love to hear from you today? Now that could be your grandma, it could be, you know, a neighbor, it could be someone you haven't spoken to for a while, but just thinking, okay, I'm going to send that person a note, I'm going to send that person an email or a card, or, you know, remember when we used to send things in the post? You could actually send them something just to say, how are you? You know, I love you, I miss you, I think about you, whatever it is. So starting your day when you do things like that, again, it's not just get up and like, you know, power through, like, you know, boss, do everything. Getting up and going, I'm going to write a card to someone and post it. I mean, wow. For me, I don't really send a lot of things in the post. So it's a nice, like, calm thing to do. And you're just sending off something great. You're just sending off this, like, beautiful energy first thing in the morning. And then lastly, the last one I'm going to share today, but as I said, you can modify these questions however you like. The last one that I sometimes use and write down is, who can I hear from? Who's most grateful? Who would love to hear from me today? The energy. What is the energy that I want to have today? What's the energy that is needed today? Now, when I say that, it's because, as you can probably tell, I am someone who has a lot of energy. I'm not caffeinated right now. This is the energy all the time. So if I was, often when I do have coffee, I'm like, I'm sorry, everyone in the room, I'm having caffeine, it's a lot. So what's the energy that is actually required for that day? So if I'm going into a situation where I need to be, you know, I need to present, I need to maybe lead, I need to have energy, then great. But there's also times when I need to go into a situation where maybe I need to listen and be calmer, and I need to be the student, and I need to pay attention and be focused. So it's a different kind of energy. So sometimes it's just, again, that bringing my awareness to, okay, what is the energy that I want to have today in this situation that I'm going into, in this conversation or in this interview or this work setting, and then just writing it down, just really crystal clear, like committing things from paper, writing it down. It just is something about that feedback loop between the brain and body that helps you to remember it and solidify it, and it becomes more embodied, and it's like, okay, this is an action I'm actually going to do, so that when I get into that arena or get into that situation, I can remember that feeling. Because again, now sitting here, there's cameras, I'm talking to you, I love to deliver this kind of thing, and I've done a lot of talks, but often, you know, people think that if you do something and you enjoy it, that you've always been good at it. But I'll be honest, the first few talks that I did, I knew I wanted to do talks, I knew I wanted to present, I knew I wanted to speak and share my energy and passion with people, but I was so nervous. I was so nervous. And so for that question, I would write down, what's the energy that I want to have today? And I'd just write down confident, or I'd write down the word courage, because it takes confidence, but it takes courage to get up and to speak and to share. And that doesn't have to be that you're presenting a whole event. That could be just presenting to 8 people in your team at work and thinking, okay, I want to feel more confident. I want to have the courage to stand up, to share my ideas, to present to my team. And I know this is often people say, they know what they're talking about. They're really, you know, passionate about it. But just the idea of standing up and presenting, suddenly they're like, oh, my paper's shaking, my voice is shaking, I feel nervous. So just writing that down in the morning, it can be really, really empowering, really impactful. And honestly, I've seen this not just in my own life, but in the lives of so many other people that I've worked with. When I talk about the power hour, and of course I'm distilling it now into 1 hour for this workshop, I'm distilling it down. And of course it's not a simple, easy, just hop out of bed at 5:30 and just have this hour, do all these things. It, you know, it takes time, and it can be, as I mentioned at the start, for some people it might be one day a week to start, or it might be two, or it might be 15 minutes, and then that becomes 30, and that becomes 45. There's different ways to like enter into this idea of, you know, restructuring your morning. But one thing that I will say, and I say this with so much sincerity, is that do not, please, underestimate how much 1 hour can really change your life. How much changing one thing, like I said, that first domino to fall, it can truly transform your entire life. It can transform your mindset, your career, your confidence. So please, if you're listening to some of these ideas and thinking, okay, maybe I'll give this a go, then start now. Start tomorrow. Set your alarm. Go to bed a little bit earlier tonight. I'm not advocating sleep deprivation. Go to sleep a little earlier so you can wake up a little bit earlier. Start with the power hour. Choose yourself is what you deserve, and make time to do all those important things, those goals, those ambitions, those races, those books. You can do it all. You just can't do everything at the same time. Thank you so much for joining. And I'm going to take a breath, I'm going to take a drink, and then I'm going to start to answer some of the questions. I can already see a few of the questions coming in. If you haven't already, then now's the time. So go, 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 pop the questions in, and I'll answer as many as I can. Okay, so the first question is, do you think that starting your day with exercise makes a difference to productivity? So I guess from a neurological perspective, if you start your day with exercise, then of course you are going to increase oxygen to the brain, you're going to hopefully reduce stress. So when it comes to productivity, if there's something, as I mentioned, around like kind of the mindset piece of like feeling busyness, feeling overwhelmed, feeling stress, then yes, I'd say choosing exercise in the morning can be a good way to kind of just reset, I suppose. So, you know, our nervous system and the adrenaline, the cortisol, we need that kind of, we need both. We need the ups and the downs, the push and the pull. So if it, so in terms of making a difference to productivity, I think yes, it can, because it can kind of, I guess, give you that energy boost and that wake up that you need. So it's kind of bit counterintuitive. Sometimes people go, oh, but I'm tired and I don't have any energy. So the last thing I want to do is work out, because I just told you that I'm tired and I have no energy. But then when you do the exercise, when you do the movement, when you do start to shift that endocrinic system, so as I said, hormones, when you start, especially if you can exercise outside, oxygen in, maybe melatonin, getting some natural daylight if you're outside, then you can start to, you know, regulate your circadian rhythm, and exercise in the morning will help with a lot of things. So yes, productivity, it can help, because it can just, I guess, wake you up and feel like before 8 a.m. you're like, oh, okay, I'm actually awake, as opposed to, as I said, if you're scrolling on your phone, start the laptop, it's like, okay, what day is it? Who am I? What time is it? And suddenly you're in a meeting, because we've all been there. We've all been there. Next question is from Jenny, and it says, what time do you go to bed? Now, this is a great question, Jenny. This question always comes up when I talk about the power hour. How many hours sleep do you get a night? And I can't function on less than 8. Okay, so first things first, 8 hours, that is great. I don't think that people should be sleeping less than 7. So if you want a great reference, great book, Matthew Walker, Why We Sleep. I mean, that book will literally scare you to bed. You will read that book and you're like, he just talks about how important sleep is for our health, for our brain function, mind, body. And I was like, I'm putting that book down and I'm going to bed at 4 p.m. because it's just so important when you read some of these stats. So don't want to scare you, but if you want a real deep dive on the data and the stats, then definitely recommend Matthew Walker, Why We Sleep. Now, I try to go to bed before 10 p.m. That's kind of the golden rule. And again, depending on your lifestyle, where you're at in your life, how old you are, whether you have kids, whether you don't have kids, I'll be honest, it's a challenge. It is not easy to go to bed before 10, because there's a plethora of things that can distract us and keep us up. Netflix, phones, social media. If your kids have only just gone to bed, then often people are like, well, then that's my time. When the kids have only just gone to bed, I don't want to then go to bed myself. But for me, I just had to be, I can be quite binary about decision making, and I'm very focused, and I decided, okay, what are the things that you're doing in the evening that are making you go to bed late? And real talk now, are they worth it? Are they worth it? If you want to stay up and watch TV, fine, that's up to you. If you want to, you know, faff around and scroll on your phone, there's no judgment. We all do whatever we want to do, but is it worth it? Is it worth waking up later, not being able to have time for yourself in the morning, not being able to train for that race, not being able to do all this? It's just, if it's worth it, so there's a trade-off. So I'd say if you can go to bed before 10, then hopefully you'll still be able to get up a little earlier and still feel good and have the energy to go after all the things that you want to. Okay, could definitely talk more about sleep, but there is a whole chapter about sleep in the book. Okay, so the next one is, do you think alcohol is a real blocker for productivity? Wow, okay, so what I think about alcohol, and again, this is a very individual thing, and I am not a nutritionist, so please do your own research when it comes to alcohol, but it's often about habit, and when something becomes a habit, we kind of build a tolerance to it, so we think that it doesn't affect us. So people will say to me, oh, I drink 3 coffees, or oh, I drink wine, but it doesn't affect me. I can still, you know, get up, or I feel a bit foggy-headed in the morning until I have my first coffee, but it's fine. And so sometimes I think it's actually about understanding like what your like reset level is. And so if you don't drink for a while, or if you don't drink caffeine or alcohol or whatever it is, if you cut it out for a while, whether it was 48 hours, 3 days, 5 days, 7 days, however long you want, then you can start to really assess like, how do I feel without it versus how do I feel with? Because I think that's often where the line gets really blurred. It's like, well, I think I feel fine without it. Is it that? Is it sleep? Is it stress? There's all these things layered together. It's hard to isolate one thing and say, oh, it's just the red wine or it's just the beers. But of course, we know that anything in excess, it's not gonna help us sleep. It's not gonna help us to function the next day. It's actually not even gonna help with our mood. So if you track your cycle, any women who track their cycle, then there's certain times as well when it's really more impactful on low mood. So I definitely think, you know, do your own research when it comes to alcohol, but if you can, just do a simple trial and error without and with, and really be honest with yourself. Honesty, note down how did you feel without it versus how you feel with. Okay, next question is from Haley, and it says, how do you deal with others draining your energy or blocking your goals? I love that question, Haley. That is a really important question because, of course, a lot of what I'm talking about today, it's about the individual. So it's the individual pursuit, you know, do these things, prioritize yourself. But we don't live our lives as individuals, we live with others. We don't live in isolation. So it could be, you know, living with a partner who doesn't want to get up early, or a partner who says, oh, have one more glass of wine, don't be silly. Or it could be somebody, I don't know, who, like you say, if they're blocking your kind of your energy and kind of bringing you down, then it's a really difficult thing. It's not as simple as just saying, you know, just get rid of those people. It's not always possible. So I would say first things first is to communicate with that person. Communicate with that person what it is, what's the goal. They don't have to support you and do it with you, but ask them and be honest with them and say, look, this is really important to me. You don't have to do it with me, but you can't, I'd really appreciate if you would support me and not kind of derail me. Because actually it really holds me back when you, like I said, say, oh, it doesn't matter, or oh, I'll do it next week, or oh, I'll start tomorrow, because we all know that people can do that, because ultimately it feels good for them, because then you're, you know, in the same camp as them doing what they want to do. So yeah, it's a difficult one. I'm not going to say just cut it off like a bad weave. I'm going to say just try to, yeah, honest communication, and tell them how important it is to you. And hopefully if they love and support you, they are going to love and support this goal. Okay, next one. I struggle mixing productivity with a busy social life. Do you think it's really possible? Okay, so firstly, great that you have a busy social life. So, so important. Relationships, apparently, when it comes to looking at all of the markers for life longevity, so diet, exercise, where you live in the world, and relationships is actually the thing that determines, so the strength of your relationships determines how long you live. That is how important socializing and our relationships are. So it's not how many relationships you have, but the quality of them actually determines how long you live. So very important that we prioritize our social relationships. But what I would say is, it kind of goes back to that seasons part, you know, like what is the season? Because if the season right now is, you know what, spending time with friends, is a new relationship that you're in, really pouring into that, then I think, like I said, pour into that, like do it fully, do it wholeheartedly. Maybe it's a few months time, or maybe it's a year, or another time when you have this season where you're hyper-focused and you are working on a different goal. I don't think you should try to layer things on top, as I said, because that way it's like, okay, I'm going to this thing because I want to, and I want to enjoy myself, and I'm going to get home late, but I'm going to get up early, and I'm going to do all the things, and it's too much. So lean into whichever season you want, choose the one that's making you happy right now, and you'll know when it's time to change. You'll know when it's time for the next season. Okay, the next question is, I find stress really limits my productivity. Do you have any tips on helping me keep it under control? Okay, yes, I do. So what I say about stress is that pressure and stress are not the same thing. So pressure aids performance. It's the kind of idea that, you know, people say the night before an exam, for example, the night before they have to submit something, and they're like, I do my absolute best work when the last minute, the last hour, when my back's against the wall, that is when I deliver because I know I have to. Whereas for other people, you know, they might not enjoy that feeling at all. It's very debilitating. And that building up over time is stress. So there are two different things. There's pressure, aids performance, you know, the moments on your spotlight, on live camera action or start line of the race, that is pressure. Stress is what builds up over time. It's the debilitating part because the preparation previously wasn't there. So when I think about stress, as I say, it's not about just eliminating stress from our lives. That's not possible. There'll always be stress. I think it's more looking at what's the consistent stress. If there's something that week on week, month on month, that thing is stressing you out, something needs to change there. So what's the planning? What's the thing that's missing that is causing you to be so stressed? Because, you know, like I said, moments of high pressure, fine, but living under constant stress, it's debilitating and it can cause poor physical health and mental health as well. So my top tip around it is to, like I said, identify, okay, even if it is writing down, okay, this thing happens again and again and again and again, and it always leads me to feel stressed, and then work backwards from that. So what could change? Do you need to outsource? Is there something, when we write these lists of all the things we have to do in a day, what's essential and what's just there and what's making you stressed? What can you just cross off and you don't even have to do it, you know? What's the thing you could delegate to someone else? What's the thing you need support? What's the thing that someone else can help you with? And you just be honest and say, look, this is too much. I need some support with this. So look at the thing, eliminate some things that are stressing you out, and look for the consistent themes that over time are making you stressed. But if it's just pressure, hopefully it can aid the goal. Okay, and then I think there's one more, which is, but we still have a little bit of time, so if you have one, drop it in now. Do you think people need to be accountable for their own energy? Because I really absorb other people's energy. Okay, again, this is a great question. Of course, we have to be responsible. We are adults. We have to say, okay, this is on you. You want to achieve this thing. No one's going to get up and run the miles for you to train for the race. Like I said, I'm quite, I guess, to myself, I'll say, okay, Adrienne, you could read all day long about doing push-ups. But if you're not going to actually do them, you're not going to get the benefit. So, of course, we have to be accountable ourselves for our actions, and we have to do what we have to do. But of course, other people can impact that. So whether it's other people's comments, other people's ideas, some people rolling their eyes, oh, you're doing that thing again, you're not gonna stick to it. But I think there comes a point where you have to kind of, if you know that you're very influenced by others, really trying to not just focus on the negative, but trying to flip that around. So for example, I talk a lot. I mean, surprise, surprise. So if someone's saying, like, for example, growing up at school, I'd always get, she talks too much, she talks too much, she talks too much. Or someone else might use that as a criticism, you know, oh, you talk too much, you should listen more, or you ask too many questions, just shush. But actually, if you think of everything as a dial, like you've got 0 and then you've got 100. Most people have 0 to 10. Let's go to 100. Anything all the way to extreme, of course, it could be bad, but anything all the way to 0, if you took it away, then that can be your thing, that can be your superpower if you like. So I think finding somewhere on that dial where it's like, okay, what's the positive in what that person's saying, whether it's affecting your mood, affecting your energy, bringing you down, maybe that thing, for example, someone saying, oh, I don't know, you talk too much, you're distracting, stop asking questions and just get on with it. That could be a criticism that I could, you know, bring me down. Or I can say, actually, if I just dial it down a little bit, it's because I am inquisitive, I am curious, I have a lot of questions, I want to know everything. So it's kind of finding the good in it if you can, not to just, you know, silver lining everything. But what's the thing that there, yeah, is bringing you down, and trying to extract something good from that if possible. Okay, so there's one more question that's come in, and it says, if all of this isn't possible, what are 3 small life changes someone could make? Okay, great. So 3 small life changes, I would say, the first one is to look at your schedule. And I mentioned before about white space, but the first thing would be to take some white space for yourself and put it in your schedule right now. Set an alarm on your phone if you need to. That time is a hold. You can't be for anyone else, can't be for anything else. It's just for you to sit down and to think and reflect and go, okay, where do I wanna start? What are the things that are bringing me the most joy in my life? Do I have enough of those things? Do I have enough time for those things? And what are the things that I really want to change the most? What are the things that cause me unhappiness, that cause me stress? What are those things? And just being honest and reflecting and just starting there. Because as I said, if we're busy all the time, we never have that opportunity to just reflect and just go, right, literally again, I'm a big fan of like, get a pen and paper, write less and write more, and then line in the middle. What do you want less of? What do you want more of? Less stress, less obligations, less, more sleep, more whatever it is, and then you've got it there. You can look at it. And from there, you can start to think about making changes. Start with the less and more. The second one would be to, I'm just going to throw out a challenge out there, would be to try and have a phone-free power hour within the next 7 days. So that basically just means that the first hour that you wake up, you don't look at your phone. You don't even, like, leave it in another room. Like, don't even make it hard for yourself because it's right there and it's, like, you know, vibrating and giving you notifications. Put it in the kitchen and go to bed. And when you wake up in the morning, do something for an hour before you go and get the phone. And sometimes it's just that breaking the habit and the loop that's like, wow, I felt so different today. I did something different this morning. And maybe that will be something that you'll want to continue. And then last but not least, since you asked for 3 small things, and I've given you loads, one more small thing could be to ask someone else. So often when we think about ourselves and our goals, it's like me. I want to do this. I want to do that. How can I do it? Ask someone else, what is one goal that they want to achieve within the next year? What would it take for them to do it? Listen to them, support them, encourage them. I often say I'm a professional encourager. It feels so good to encourage people and help them to figure it out and say, you know what, I'll help you to be accountable. Tell me what the goal is. And then listen to them and encourage them and tell them, you know, to pursue it. Whether it's, like I said, signing up to a race, taking on a new course, tell that guy that you like him, whatever. But just encourage someone this week. And I think that kind of snowball effect goes around, comes around. You'll get that encouragement back. So that's the last question. And we've got 5 minutes to spare because I just have so much to say. So thank you so much for joining. I know that I am the last event and the last talk of the entire day. So thank you to Clarins for having me. I know the Virtual Beauty Festival has been so busy. There's been so many wonderful things happening. I hope that you've really, really enjoyed it. And as I said at the start, I want you to feel motivated, of course, but motivation alone is not enough. So anything that you've learned this weekend, anything that you've been inspired by or you've listened to, you've wanted to give a try, this is the time. This week, make it a priority, take action and do something to make a start. Thank you so, so much.